Passive investing for India, 19 tips for out-of-state real estate investors. Real estate investing, if you're a real estate investor who's outside of Indiana and you wanted to invest in Indiana, here's 19 tips for out-of-state real estate investors to create a $10,000 a month passive income in the Indy market. Tip number one, close fast equals better deals. How to get realtors to bring you $25,000 deals and beg you to take them. That's a good one. That's a good good headline. Okay, guys, Azameo Big Rhea, Azameo rhymes with KO, bigrhea.com. Over the last several weeks, I've talked to at least 100 real estate investors who are doing what's called remote investing or absentee investing. They live outside of Indiana, anywhere, not just in America, but outside the country. And they are investing in real estate in Indiana, and they're trying to create passive income. And I asked about 100 or so, at least 100, and then about 50 or so local investors. And I asked them, what's the biggest thing I could do to help? And the number one thing was people said, you know that passive income thing we're doing, the 52 tips on how to create passive income for real estate investors, business owners, all that stuff. Could you do one of those just for people in Indiana? And you know what? I love you guys. I'm going to do that. So this is a new series just for out-of-state passive real estate investors, Indiana passive investors, passive investing Indiana. You guys shall be taking notes on this. This is exactly how we want to start. When we introduce people, this is the beginning of the curve. So we want to make sure that they can go through this material and understand what we're going to do. So if you are trying, the whole goal here is to own enough real estate and own enough rental properties to create 10 to 30 grand a month in total passive income, completely passive income. This is a new series for out-of-state investors who have at least $100,000 cash, great credit in 3 to 5 years. The process here is that you take 3 to 5 years, 5 to 7 years, and you try to create a 10 to 20, 30 grand a month passive income. It all comes down to how you build your team. So if you're a passive investor, I'm going to explain what that means in a second between active investing. But the number one skill you need to build is building your team. You need to qualify your team. And I promise you this, guys, when I was, for those of you that know my story, we were in the bottom of the barrel as far as Indiana goes. And that's like the bottom of the country. So we all live in a studio apartment, didn't have income or anything. I always said to myself, I wanted to, number one, get to a place where I had passive income of $1 million a year or more. And when I did that, I want to show other people how to do it. This is what I and everyone on our team here, we've been touched by God to do this, to be able to help people create this change. I promise you the stuff in this series, we sat down and came up with tips. We came up with 19 quick tips here. So this is the first in a series of classes that we're going to have different tips specifically on how you can get better at being a passive investor and building your 10 to 30 grand a month, how you can do it at light speed. I promise you this series, these classes, it's good stuff. It'll help you become unstoppable and you'll be in a league of your own. You'll be a world-class investor. So what the first thing to realize is it comes down to building your team. You got to build your team. You got to know how to qualify your team. You have to have a specific passive income target and asset acquisition plan. That's tip number three, I think. We're going to talk about the exact how to look at how much equity you need, because the whole passive income, making 100 grand a year passive income, means that you need $1 million producing at 10%, right? Or $2 million producing at 5%, or some other number producing at X percent. So we're going to talk about what real estate allows you to do is to get equity with leverage. And we use BRRRR or other methods, we can use that equity. You guys are clear on this. Is there a question on that? Oh, you're talking, right. So we're going to talk about that later, debt service, because you get equity and you borrow money to do that. You have leverage, now you have debt, but that debt service is paid by the renter. We're not going to talk about that right now, but this is what you need to have. You need to be able to say, hey, whenever we talk to an investor, one of the first things we do is establish the 10 or 25 grand or 30 grand or whatever. We need to establish that target. You should have that in your mind. The T3, the main things you have here, it's your team, your targets, and your timeline. You should be able to say, I want $30,000 a month. That's my goal. And here's exactly how I'm going to do it. And your team should be able to do that. You should have definite targets with what you need to hit every month, every day, every week, where you need to be at every quarter, your acquisition. And your team should have that too. And you should know your timeline. If I ask you as a passive investor, how long is it going to take you before you're at $30,000 a month? You should in one sentence be able to answer that question. If not, you need to tweak with your team. So that's how to use these classes. Use these to build your team better if you're not working with us. You can also apply to work with us. Go to bigrhea.com at the very top. Click on, by the way, Azameo, rhymes with K. I already say this. Bigrhea.com, the world's number one. We're building the world's largest organization of special needs business owners and real estate investors, while also being the number one channel for Indiana real estate, number one YouTube channel for Indiana real estate. No big deal. All kinds of real cool stuff. Go to bigrhea.com. But that is, you can click on the turnkey and you can get more information on that and more details on that. I keep thinking you're raising your hand. Is it my skin stuff? I thought I've been doing good with that. Skin stuff's clearing up a little bit. Thank you guys so much for the kind words, by the way. All the encouragement as I work through my skin stuff. Okay, what's the difference between a passive and active investor? You guys can answer this question, right? There's basically three things. Active investing. So people who are broke, when we talk to people who are broke, what do? Click, we hang up right now. We want to help these people as well. So if you don't have 100 grand, if you don't have great credit, you don't have 5 years, you can still do the active investing part. The difference between active investing and passive investing, the three main differences: active investor, you're generating leads. You have to go out and you have to figure out how to generate leads, and you have to convert those leads, and you have to build your fan base. This is the whole business process. You need to understand the five crowds, those things. you are having to do that as an active investor. And you can do this with no money, no cash, no credit, but you really have to build your business building skill. Passive investing, you're not going to do any of that. You're not going to market for sellers. You're not going to look for motivated sellers. Go to bigria.com, click on our motivated seller page. It's one of the top resources, according to Google, like number three or four. It should be number one, a resource on finding motivated sellers for free. And that, all that stuff is a passive investor. You're not going to be doing that. But it's important that you know how your team is generating leads and what they're doing. So as a passive investor, keep your finger on that pulse. The more you know, the better. Time. Again, the most important question we always say is, what's the most important question anybody will ever ask is, how will I spend my time today? Financially speaking, the most important thing anyone's ever going to do is make the decision and the process to create passive income. That's what this is all about, creating passive income. In this case, 30 grand a month. Today's lesson to improve your passive income skill. Being able to close fast is vital in getting the best deals in any market. You need to understand the entire process so you may help them, so you can help. You can help your team calibrate. Today, you'll see the whole closing process and how to weaponize it for residuals. Who wrote that? Weaponize it for residuals. Who wrote that's a good one. I saw you writing that at the beginning. I thought that was a good one. Weaponize it for residuals. By the way, copywriting is a skill you want to learn right there. Weaponize it for residuals. We always take an asset and use the term weaponize it. Take something normal, but do it in such a way where it's weaponized. I love that. Today, you'll see the whole closing process and how to weaponize it for residuals. This is, if you're a passive investing, you need to understand how the closing process works and how to go through it really quickly. A few quick notes, since this is our first class in this series. Okay, learn the SA numbers. If you haven't gone through the SA class, you should check that out. That's more for active investors, but passive investors. Social ascension, income ascension, social mobility, it's dead in America. It only happens with foreigners, first generation. They're hungry, they're nuts. They come here and they have nothing but gratitude for America. She took my comments. I knew she was laughing. Because look, I said, let me tell you something, guys. When I was growing up, we qualified for food stamps. Well, we were never on food stamps or assistance or anything. But in my apartment complex, other people were. And one of the first things that my family did is that they got they bought animals. They eventually bought this whole slaughterhouse, but at first they had animals so that they could kill them in a certain way so that it's halal or kosher. And then we would have a whole bunch of meat, and we'd bring the meat back to our apartment complex. And oh my goodness gracious, the way people freaked out. Oh my gosh, meat, you guys got so much meat. And we had all this meat, and people freaked out about having meat because they had never eaten meat. I knew people who were my age, who were twice as old as me, who were teenagers and even in their 20s, who had never had or maybe once had meat. And it was such a rare thing to have meat. That was the context. You didn't talk about the context. Because I remember people used to come crying, like, oh, Lord bless you. Jesus bless you. Thank you so much for giving us meat. So it got to a point where we didn't even eat much of the meat. We would come bring in, we'd eat maybe, 25% of our meat, and we'd give a lot of it away to our neighbors because they were so hungry and they were so blown away that they'd never seen that much meat before in their lives. So when I had gone into, we used to go to the inner city then. We used to have papers and stuff like that. So if there was a apartment complex, the Meadows at 38th and Keystone. We used to go there, and there's another one, another Meadows, there's another extension, the Courts, that was a little bit further down in Indianapolis. But we used to go there on Saturdays and Sundays and hand out meat. I could give out meat. And I remember this one guy came up to me, they didn't have enough meat for everybody, so they would take a drawing. It was like a lottery. And this one guy came up to me, I never forgot it. He took a lottery out. He took his drawing out for his, there's a point here. I'm coming back to the point. This does have to do with passive income. But this guy came out, and he, not really actually, this is not directly related to what we were talking about, but you brought this up here. You put this slide in. So that's what we're talking about. This guy, and she's talking all kinds. She's just starting shit, man. The saying that I was, okay. So this guy came up and he took one of his, he was winning and he'd won. He was able to get meat. He came up to me. I never forgot this. He said, listen, I got my meat and I've got the ticket for meat, but can I trade it for you? Can I give it to you and you can give it to someone else and I can come back closer to Christmas so that I can have meat with my family because my kids have never had meat. And when he said that to me, I was like, oh my gosh, man. It's like, that's the kind of stuff we're talking about, right? So fast forward to a couple years ago, we were driving that same place, 38th and Keystone, the Meadows, and we had an individual I was with. Again, I'm vegan, mostly. Vegetarian always, but almost always vegan. And he had meat because it was one of these guys that was delivering some of the, they go through like 500 cows or 500 goats a week, crazy business. But I said, hey, you know what? You want to do something really cool? Let's pull over here and let's hand out this meat. And so we went out there, talked to this guy, talked to people, started coming around our truck, and we started handing out meat. And all of a sudden they're like, hey, how old is this meat? Where'd you get it from? They had all these questions about like, is it salmonella? How has it been, has it been in the danger zone too long with E. coli? It's like, wait, what? And so I started talking to this guy. One of these guys, I went to his apartment. Okay, this is the rest of the story. He had two freezers full of meat. And he had every kind. Now, my point being that if you are on food stamps now, if you're on government assistance now, I had no idea. Before, it's like you never got meat. Now, you get meat, you get fish, you get, lobster, every type of meat there was. That was the context of what I said. I'm not saying, her comment was, oh, the mail says that that people on food stamps have it too easy or have it too good. That's not what I said. What I said is that there's a certain level of gratitude that's built in you if you don't have that stuff. And certain, like if you look at it, like everything's relative. In America, nobody's really suffering, right? It's like, yeah, you get a Camry, but oh, I want an Escalade. Like that's the attitude that people have about this. This, when it comes down to like the SA numbers, the Terman study, social mobility, income ascension is non-existent in America. But everything is getting better. Everything's getting wonderful. I'm going to talk about, did you put the other stuff here in a second? All right, so put a pin in that. I'll come back to that about how everything's getting better. I'll come back to that. The SA numbers, social mobility, income ascension, it's non-existent in America. Nobody moves except for immigrants, people who come here and see America through nothing, the lens of gratitude. Those are the only people that do that, that create social mobility. This is about creating social mobility, getting to 30 grand a month, which is the top 1%, and then staying there indefinitely, doing it in a way that's sustainable and that fulfills you and your family. We talk about the Forever Fund, the idea that you have a set amount of money that creates such a return, you live on part of it, but reinvest the rest so it keeps you in the 1% indefinitely for generations, generational wealth. The Terman study in America, we like to believe, I talk a lot about this, that it's IQ. The guy who did this, Lewis Terman, he was a famous social scientist, I guess you could say. He was also he believed in, you know, a lot of crazy stuff, but his ideas initially were, you know, a lot of ugly beliefs about race and how race, you know, if, you know, black people are dumb, basically. And he did this study about IQ, took the highest IQ people. We've talked about that. Everyone here should know the study, right? You guys know what I'm gonna say. Does anyone not know? He took the highest IQ kids, 250,000 kids, followed them over 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 years. And turns out that the highest IQ, the absolute, the top one half of 1% IQ, they ended up performing basically exactly where their parents did. Nothing determines where you're gonna go in life more than where your parents went. And this is why breaking out of that mold, income ascension, social mobility is so important. This movie, Old, is that what you put in here? We've been talking a lot about this movie, Old, and how it has to do with passive income and how your time, it's this M. Night Shyamalan Ding Dong movie, and some of his movies are brilliant. He's absolutely brilliant, but other movies are like, oh my gosh, are you kidding? The Village, Lady in the Water, are you serious? But Old is one of those movies that has made us talk. We've been talking a lot about this. I'm glad you put this in here. I didn't know what you meant at first, but that we spent a lot of time talking about time and time dilation. Old, if you don't know, there's this beach. You get on the beach, and once you're on the beach, there's no way off, and 1 hour is like 3 years. So your time goes by all really fast, super fast. And so the reason, there's some really brilliant things that have been covered in that script and in that movie. It's based on a comic book called Sandcastles, but this idea that age speeds time. So how do they know what's happening on this island when you first get there? They notice, you can see this in the trailer. I'm not going to spoil the movie, but you see it because of the kids. The kids end up growing rapidly. They look at the kids, a really small 1 minute, and then like a half hour later, they're much bigger. And that is what happens with time. The older you get, the faster time goes, because time, if you're 10 years old, 1 year is 10% of your life. But if you're, you know, if you're 20 years old, that same 1 year is only 5% of your life, right? And the older you get, the smaller and smaller of amount of time that this, how smaller, the less significant it is. You know, when the kids are like, we don't get to see our cousins till January or till December, or in December, they're like, we're not going to see them till June. That's forever. But like a 5-year-old, that does seem like forever. For us, it's like, ain't no thing. It's like day after tomorrow. But that's what happens with time, is the older you get, this is one of the only movies that's covered this. The older you get, the faster it goes and the more it disappears. The other thing about this is, if you only had 1 day to live, which is what happens on the beach, it's like one hour is 3 years. So you have like 75 years in 1 day. So if you're a kid, you might live 24 hours, but you're going to be like in your 70s or 80s, right? Or like 1 year is 2 years. 1 hour is 2 years, 2 to 3 years. But it forces you to focus on what's important. And so there's arguments in the movie where people are like, you know, we don't have much time. We don't have a lot of time for this stuff. Steve Jobs talked about this. He said, always ask yourself, you know, if you died today, would you do what you're going to do? If you only had 1 day to live, immediately it gives you perspective, not just gratitude, but also you start questioning everything you're doing. Do I really want to, there's a couple in the movie that argue. They say, do we really want to argue? They just started like disagreeing on something. And she said, we already spent a week arguing. You know, do we really want to continue doing this? And when you have 1 day to live, it focuses your stuff. There's two things here. First, age speeds time. The older you get, the faster time's going by. And we talk about specifically when it comes to passive income, you don't have time to be led down a blind alley. You don't have time to reverse and to correct course. You just don't have time for that. You don't have time for BS. The number one thing, when I talk to the, I've been talking to a lot of people who are invested in Indiana lately, because I'm getting back into this, because Anna's got me, you know, just really got me into this stuff now more. And I've been looking at, the number one thing that people say to me is, you know, it's not the fact that these people took advantage of me or that these people were LLCs or whatever, but it's the fact that I don't know what to do next. I don't have a good solution. I don't know how to get around this. And ultimately what it comes down to is, you know, you're losing time. That's the crazy thing. People say after the 2008 crash, oh, well, the prices came back. Yeah, but you lost 10 years. We lost a decade. Time is so important to keep track of time and to understand I ask myself this all the time. There's absolutely nothing one of the most important things I can do with my time is to help to take these lessons and these resources that we have and make them available to other people so they can improve their situation. Also, the last thing is about the comic book. I went out when M. Night bought the script, bought the rights to the movie. It's like about a year before the movie came out. I went out and bought it. I sent it to you. And I said, you should check this out. And I read it, and I was not that, I get the, I want to know, like, what was it that impressed him? And I guess it's the idea of the beach, because the actual comic book itself, I'm not ruining the movie at all, but there's a lot of nihilism, like pointlessness. The reason it's called Sandcastles is it's this idea that nothing you do in your life, everything you do in your life is as pointless as a sandcastle that gets washed away with the waves of time very quickly. And the people on the beach are just symbolic of how we are. We think we're doing stuff that's useful, but ultimately it's not. And I think that's so, like, it's such a dark and such a morbid way to look at it. Ultimately, though, what changes that? I think for a lot of people, they are building a sandcastle. When they come and go, they have very little to show for it. But ultimately, it's service to others. Ali said, service to others is the rent you pay for your time on earth. And that ultimately is what we're all about. Creating passive income, not so you can not do anything and just sit back, but that you can help other people do it. See the ladder, climb the ladder, help others, send the elevator back down for others, like Kevin Spacey said. Because if you live in a world where we can't listen to Kevin Spacey, I don't know what to say, right? But service to others avoids your time from being useless and having this like nihilistic view of the world or your activity. What you do actually does matter, does have an impact. We are all on that beach. Time is moving fast. There's a bunch of other lessons we have from this. Time dilation in general. If you don't do anything, your time disappears. I've talked a lot about this. If you've gone through my other classes, there were experiments done on this. I'll tell this one real quickly. Michelle in France, he went to an island. He didn't do anything. And for 45 days, or he was going to stay there for 90 days. 45 days later, the helicopter came and got him, right? And he's like, why'd you come back? It's only been 45 days. They said, no, it's been 90 days. His experience of time had collapsed by 2 to 1. He was living 2 days, but only experiencing 1 day because he wasn't doing anything. Monotony makes time disappear. Because people say this all the time. Where did the week go? Where did the month go? Oh, what month is it? What year is it? Time flies. Time flies when you're not doing shit, when you don't have anything to show for it. This is exactly what happened with other people. They went underground. We were talking about this earlier. They went underground because he thought, can I have this effect happen with other people who are in a group? And if you don't see the sun, or if you don't have a clock and you're underground, the same thing happened. It takes about 45 to 90 days before your experience collapses. And it collapses again and again, where you can live 1 week, but only experience a day. Or no, you can live a week, right? You can live a week and experience only a day because it's just like you're on that beach. Time is flying by because you're not doing anything. It just disappears. Our work is all about making the most of your time. That's the whole point here, is that you really got to get passive income and you really start looking at your time. And when you understand that, you're not going to do anything for money. The reason why people don't build passive income is because they don't have the education or resources. Most of what people do when they get up is they go out and they do something for money that they don't want to do, that they don't like to do. They're not really being fulfilled by it. It's really easy to take these steps and create passive income. Our work is about viral volunteerism, GXMs, volunteering. We have building volunteer armies, ladders, see the ladder, climb the ladder, help others climb the ladder, and generational wins. The real question is not to know why people rebel, but why they don't rebel. This is the psychologist Wilhelm Reich. This is a pretty fascinating question. We talk about this quite a bit now. Like, it's because there's not this, the oppression is not there. The overt oppression is not there. People generally will pretty much, wherever they're born, they stay. There's no social mobility or income ascension, like I said. So wherever people are born, they kind of stay there because of their standards. Very rarely do people ever try to get out of it. The real question is not why people rebel, but why they don't rebel. It's such a powerful concept. Creating passive income isn't the goal. It's a natural side effect of having high frequency thinking, raising your thinking up to the gamma rays. You can go through our quantum physics class on that. It's the single biggest secret we teach here, is to keep high quality thoughts. Life is short unless you use it. Unless you use it, right, Seneca? Right, just like we were talking about, time disappears unless you do a whole bunch of really cool stuff with it. Set records. Be ashamed. Oh, I love this one. Michael Dyson, the physicist, said he wants this on his tombstone. Be ashamed to die until you've won some victory for humanity. All of our stuff is about this. The happiness of your life depends on the quality of your thoughts. Quality thought control. It's the biggest secret that I have right now. All the work we're doing with all our heroes, it's because they're able to adjust their frequency of thinking. This is infinite gratitude mindset. The single greatest time to be alive. Breakthroughs. CRISPR. Biotech. Solar power. Quantum computing. Do we ever talk about passive income? Is this the right class? Is this for this? Never been easier to... Oh, I see. Okay. So the whole point of all our stuff is there's all these things out there to do. So the number one thing we hear, I ask again and again, people always come up to us. They say, listen, I want to do exactly the kind of stuff you're doing. We have companies that we're working with, or that we own parts of, that are in almost all of these things. CRISPR, the ability to go in and take your DNA and open it like a Word document and delete the things that we don't like. It turns out there's about 5 or 10 genes. If you take them out, we get rid of all regenerative diseases. Your lifespan immediately doubles from 75 to 150 to 200. One of our companies, we're building the first, we want to have a world where the average human lifespan is like 300 years. That's one of our hooks. And it's CRISPR technology is part of it. Biotech, all kinds of crazy stuff happening with cloning and the ability to regenerate cells. Solar power. The richest people always ask me, where are the hottest markets in the world right now? Remember this one sentence more than anything else. Poorest places on earth right now are the sunniest places. What solar power is doing, the shift it's having around the world. Look at what happened in Ghana. They've had no power. All of a sudden they had so much power now, they can give it to their neighbors for free. What's happening with solar, with wind, with being able to have generation, like water generating plants, or having power plants? plants. There is so much, just a single dam can transform an entire continent, right? Just a single, the solar power, the technologies that we're able to create out of this is totally revolutionizing the world. It's turning everything upside down. This is the single greatest time to be alive. That's exactly right. These are the things you should be so excited to get out of bed like a bullet to be able to be part of these things. And the reason you're not, people always say, I want to do the stuff you guys are doing. The reason they're not is because they don't have enough passive income. They haven't built the systems to do that, to be able to focus on the contributions they want to make and changes they want to make in the world. Quantum computing, for the first time ever now, we have a computer that can, what a normal computer, the fastest computer we know of, would take 3 million years to solve a problem. Quantum computer does it in seconds. The advancements that are coming from this are insane. Basically, we're able to go into other dimensions, borrow data, and come back into our own dimension. I could talk more about that. It's really crazy stuff. AI, artificial intelligence. We are building now a clone, a digital clone of people that is now in the process of going out and finding jobs because of what's happened with COVID. You can go out and find a job remotely, and you could just imagine having a clone of yourself that goes out, and you can send him to medical school, and he'll go off and do it at an accelerated rate, come back, and then you don't want to have him, you know, operating on people doing stuff like that, but like have him do coding job, have him go get a coding degree, come back, and then he goes and gets a coding job, your digital clone. Really cool stuff with AI. Drones, self-driving vehicles, the LiDAR on the Google self-driving vehicles, they were laughed at in 2011, 2012, just in the last 10 years. Now there's nobody that says that it's not just a possibility, but it's an inevitability. Self-driving vehicles, the LiDAR used to cost $75,000. Now it's like less than $100. Cloud computing, blockchain, cryptocurrencies. Right now what's happening in Africa because of cryptocurrencies, all of a sudden the warlords have to be really nice to people in some cases because people don't have, the money doesn't have to go through them. Cryptocurrencies, blockchain has allowed this. It's a revolution. And now governments, of course, are getting in on it, making their own blockchain, not realizing the irony. But cryptocurrency, I'm not saying necessarily Bitcoin, but cryptocurrency is the wave of the future. Free space Wi-Fi, this allows people to do things like cryptocurrency. Nanotechnologies, I've talked so much about this, you guys. In one grain of rice, in 1 inch, there's 30 million nanometers, right? Nanometers, nanometers. The technologies that they have right now, the one I've always talked about is the rat. They inject the rat with nanobots, these little tiny robotic ninjas. They go in, they kill the tumor, and they pass in the digestive system. Bonkers, right? Don't you want to be a part of stuff like that and contribute parts like that? You can, we have, by the way, we have a whole bunch of companies and, you know, incubators and accelerators that we work with, and that's how we get our foot in the door on these companies. But the secret to working with companies like this is you have to be able to grow businesses and build companies. We can help you do that. But the reason you're not focusing on this stuff or in making the improvements, the whole point here of this section, I think, at least from my point of view, is that it's never been easier to change the world than it is right now. You don't need to own anything. Right now, you really have a responsibility, especially if you're born in the West. You're lucky enough to be in the West. We're the luckiest human beings to ever live on the planet. We are walking on the shoulders of generations. Every time you use anything, this computer, this camera, this monitor, any of this stuff, there's millions, billions of lives that have been behind that technology that all played some role. We owe it to the humanity, to other people, to give some contribution. And there's so many advancements happening right now. We're in the middle of like 20 industrial revolutions. It's the greatest time to be alive. Service economies like Uber, real estate, microtransactions like Opendoor. People told me that, oh, just like when I made my predictions on COVID and what was going to happen with COVID, go check out that video. Everything I said is exactly what happened. I said the whole world's going to change. All these, you know, remote working is not going to go back. It's not, you know, and it's not because I'm psychic. It's because I study history and you can see what's going to happen. Opendoor is a company that's totally changing the world with real estate microtransactions. Look at the partnership they have with realtor.com now. Just type in any house on realtor and what do you see beneath it? Opendoor has a cash offer ready for you. Opendoor is going to put a lot of these iBuy homes, people out of business. You know what the percentage Opendoor can buy at? 96% of the asking price. They can buy 96% of the value and they figured out a way to make money. This is the world we're in right now. They are doing to real estate what Uber did to cabs, what Airbnb did to the hotel industry. Opendoor is, they're pretty nuts here. Education, Khan Academy is one of the greatest sites in the world, providing a world-class education to anyone for free. Industries wide as well. All healthcare, communications, transportation, education, childcare and developing, construction, banking, crowdfunding, telephony, journalism, anything. We are seeing a slow motion destruction of our democracy in the United States right now, which is a good thing because it's so corrupt and so polluted that it's a good that it's happening. We're seeing the same thing with media, the same thing with journalism. We're seeing these institutions decay, banking, and the trust in authorities and the trust in these institutions because they essentially only operate from the trust we give them. And these are all good things. I'm not saying like they're bad things. It's all great news because now we can rebuild based on ideas instead of money because, you know, things like blockchain, cryptocurrencies. We're in the middle of so many revolutions right now. It's never been easier for the individual to make a dramatic positive impact. Look at our stuff. We have the largest, just right now in our group now, we have the, just in this room actually, I think almost just about, we have the largest special needs cold case detectives in the world. We have the largest business and real estate investor organization in the world, special needs. We have the largest special needs museum. That's actually in our garage right now, but we're expanding, but still the pieces we've sold, we have heroes that are doing sometimes $1,000 to $5,000 a day as curators, salespeople, but they're curators. They're called at museums. We have, and there's a dozen other companies. You go to our Big Rea, go to our page, our about, companies that we're working with. All that stuff right now. You're able to do, man, this is like our mission. This is our, what we're all about. This is what you should be about if you work with us. This is about making changes, it's never been easier to improve the world the way you want, to put a dent in the universe, as Steve Jobs said. This is the time to go out and make that stuff happen, okay? Now, what exactly is needed for fast closings, right? Back to the whole fucking point here. The point of fast closings, this is one point of a much larger picture, okay? So fast closings, this might not seem like it has to do with, you know, living to be 300 years, but it does, because you got to put these pieces in place so you can create passive income. I don't want anyone to have, every time you go through our stuff, you should have some high frequency thinking, right? Thinking that gives you chills and butterflies. Your thoughts should get you high. That's where you should be. You should get out of bed like a bullet every day because you're so excited about the changes you're making, the contributions you're making, the help that you're having to other people. That's what we're all about. That's our mission. That's our culture. Those are our values. Our belief system is based on that kind of stuff. This is what we want to do. So, and this is what we are doing, what people on our team are doing. These guys are amazing. Everything we do when we help people with passive income, it is not to do nothing. It's to be the best of yourself, to bring the best version of yourself. So the limited time that you have left, you're able to do badass shit and really make an impact, okay? So that's what all of our stuff is about. That's why it has to do with this. So let's talk about specifically the closing fast. What do you need to do to close fast on a real estate transaction? There's 7 parts here. Number 1 is the offer, obviously, right? The second thing is a propaganda package right here. You can see this right here. This is what most people don't do. And this is why it's really important that your team has something like that, because a lot of deals fall apart. A lot of realtors might have a deal later on. You need to know how they're presenting themselves, how they're positioning themselves, and the kind of posturing they have with that realtor, with that property manager, with that seller, with that whoever is involved with that property, right? I'll talk more about this later. So that's number 2. Number 3 is the title work. So we have to get with the title company immediately and start getting that title work going. Title companies are generally LC-ish. They move very slow because they don't really usually have much incentive. And you don't always control the title company you're going to close at. We try to, but sometimes you're not always going to have control over that. So we say 24 hours, fine. But if it takes 24 hours for the title company, I'm going to show you right now how closing fast can make you an extra, you know, 50, 60, 70, 80, 100 grand a month just by closing fast. And this is the exact process to do it. So I used to, years ago when I started doing this with realtors, the first broker I ever had, we used to charge people like $25,000, $30,000 just to teach them this process. And then we'd help them do it with their title company. But this is super valuable. So then the title work. So as soon as we have an offer accepted, we get with the title company. If it's a seller's title company, we'll get with them. Hopefully it's ours, but if it's theirs, we'll tell them what we're going to do, and they go through, they get to work and make sure there's no problems. If it's our title company, they'll be ready that day, whenever we call them. Within, as long as we call them, we give them like 2 or 3 hours, they should be ready. Then we have the inspection. We get this done before the scope of work. Then we have the appraisal, then the close. So the inspection is important to have. You have to have a relationship with an inspector who can go out, who knows what you're doing, and they can come back with solid stuff. They can say, okay, look, here are the real red lines. Here are the real red lights. Here's the yellow kind of things to worry about. And then here's what's good to go. Here's the green light. This is all good. You need to know how to read that inspection report. You have to basically be an amateur inspector. I'm talking about the person on your team. So you, as Mr. Passive Investor, your team needs to know, be able to go with the inspection report really quickly. They need to be able to order it within that. It's super fast. So evaluate your real estate team with these 3 things. When they have the offer, do they get a propaganda package? I put that in parentheses because I doubt they ever do. But then do they understand how to get the title work done immediately? And then the inspection. This is not just send an inspector out and have them give you a report. You need to have a deep relationship with them. Your team does, so that they know exactly how to read that inspection report. And then how to assign, the next part is the scope of work. You need to get the contractor, whoever's going to do the work, to get out there, use that inspection, and understand the scope of work. And they should be able to get that done that day. So you want to get the inspection done immediately, within 24 hours at the most, and scope of work done within, you know, 12 hours, 9 hours. The reason those 2 things are important is because those things go together along with the appraisal. The appraisal, I'm assuming that you're getting a loan, like a hard money loan, or even if you're getting a private loan, you have to get an appraisal out. We were just talking about this earlier with getting the speed that we have. One of the top things we look at is the appraiser. We have to have a good relationship with the appraiser. And people say, oh, you shouldn't talk to the appraiser or the underwriter. We talk to them all. And your team should be too, because you need to tell the appraiser exactly what you're looking at and the comps you're looking at. Give them a sense of the neighborhood, because if they have no idea, they have no idea. We want our appraisers and our hard money lenders, and especially what we were talking about earlier, especially the underwriter, to know, look, we're in this market. Here's the deals we did last time. Here's the deals we did before. Here's how we flipped them, or we did the buy and hold. Our numbers are good. Let the hard money lender know that, or the whatever lender, if you're borrowing money, if you're using cash, you know, the appraiser's not going to be involved. But you need to get, I'm assuming worst case scenario, that you have to get financed. The appraisal comes out after the inspection and the scope of work, because now you know what's wrong with it, how much it's going to cost to fix everything. Now we get the appraisal done. Once that appraisal is on track, your hard money lender, your lender should be able to close immediately within 24, 48 hours, and then you can close quickly. So this entire process, how fast can you do this? If we get an offer accepted today, let's say it's Monday, can you close that week? Absolutely, because we can get the title work done, get the inspector, the scope of work done that day, that same Monday, get the appraisal out there Monday night or Tuesday morning. Once we get that done, we can get the go ahead from the title company and we can close as soon as Tuesday night sometimes, Wednesday morning. I know that sounds crazy. People are like, what are you talking about? Go to the classes Anna has. And we did a special class on a chunk of deals that we got from investors. I can feel it. I can feel it getting all itchy. We have a chunk of deals now, classes we're making now that are deals that we just got from realtors or from other people, some wholesalers, although a lot of times wholesalers are LC about it. But these are a chunk of deals we got from these people that just came to us because we could close deals fast. That's why I said it's super important that your team is able to close deals fast. If they're not doing this, if they're not moving through this is all you need to close a deal, by the way. Anything other than this is excessive. You don't need anything more than this. This is an entire real estate transaction from beginning to end. Here's how you can close deals in 24 or 48 hours. And when you can do that, when you can close deals super fast, when a realtor has a deal fall apart, guess who's the first person they call? And they say, hey, I got a friend of mine that can still close this deal. Like, yeah, that's going to take 30, 45 days. No, he can close like tomorrow, day after tomorrow. They give you a call. You got to be ready to get that propaganda package out. And you know, you think, why does a realtor need that? Because they give it to the seller. And they can say, here's a friend of mine. You want realtors or property managers or investors or sellers, especially sellers who you, let's say you're talking to the wife and the husband's like, well, who the fuck is this guy that you're going to give the house to for $20,000 less than, you know, they don't know what they're talking about. They can give them a nice propaganda package. They can give them your testimonials. They can see, oh, they have the largest group of special needs business owners. They have the number one channel on YouTube for Indiana real estate. No big deal again. You know, they can give them that stuff. So at least there's some context. You have some credibility. So if you do talk to them, it's not going to be an unpleasant conversation. They're going to know who you are. You have some positioning with them. So we get that offer, the propaganda package, that title work immediately, the inspections, scope of work, the appraisal, and the close. You get what I'm saying? We go through this process super fast. You can do this in 24, 72 hours. No problem. Main areas to focus on aside from the propaganda package is the inspection, the scope of work, and the appraisal. Why? Because the inspection is going to be, you could go to any property and make it seem like it's a total shithole, right? So we don't want that. We need an inspector who understands what we're doing. Listen, we buy these deals, we're doing, you know, fix and flips, or we're doing buy and hold, and here's what we're looking for. Here's what we can deal with. Just give us a good list of things that we can give to our contractor to get an accurate scope of work. You get what I'm saying? And then the appraisal, that comes down to the relationship you have with the hard money lender. Usually their underwriter is going to get it. And the way that we set this up, we have a trained team get this done about 24 hours or less. It all comes down to the policies and the checklist. We use time rules. So we have A team and B team. We have people come out. We have two or three teams of people that go out and do these. Right now, I think Anna's made a bunch of classes, man. A lot of them aren't even up yet. But I think we have like 40 or 50, maybe 60 or so projects going right now that are full rehabs that are happening right now. Some of them are for investors. Some of them are for the special needs group. Some of them are heroes and different people. And you got to have checklists. Everyone that comes into our world, listen, man, we have tight policies. We know exactly how things are done. And it's exactly, we have, you know, here are the 10 ways you answer the phone. Here's the 5 things you say to somebody who says that we need a permit for this, or somebody that, here's how we react to everything. So whenever in business, the way I've taught things, I've always said, go out, find an unknown, and then, you know, policize, checklist the way we respond to the unknown. And the world of unknowns gets smaller and smaller and smaller. And ultimately, that's how we create predictability. This, you as a passive investor are hearing this thinking, oh my gosh, do I got to do all this? No. The point is that you need to talk to your team and understand that your team needs to train your people to be able to do this. I promise you, I've had testimonials, some of our old testimonials when I used to do this lightning fast closing or speed of light closings, I think it was called. Look at the testimonials. People said, once I got this down, oh my gosh. First of all, everyone's going to love you. Your inspectors are going to love you because they're doing regular inspections. Your scope of work people, your contractors are going to love you because they're getting regular work. The title company's going to love you because you're closing deals. The realtors, all these people are going to love you because you look like a genius because you can do deals so fast. Get your team performing like this. So here's the time rules that we use. If we call you, do we have this on here? The times actually. Okay, so I think it's before noon. If we let you know about it before noon, it has to be done that day. So if it's the appraisal, if it's the scope of work, if it's the inspector, if we know before noon, get out there today. Get the inspector out there today, get the scope of work, get the appraisal today. Now the appraisal takes a little bit longer. They're going to have that ready for us the next day. So the appraisal from when he leaves the property, we'll give him 12 hours. So let's say he gets there at 7 p.m. We've had these guys out there like midnight at 1 a.m. and they get it to us at 7 in the morning. We always say, look, try to get it to us by 10 a.m. Because if we get it by 10 a.m., assuming that we contacted the title company the day before, because we contact the title company first, like I said, it may take them a full 24 hours. But once that's done, let's say that we contact the title company at noon today, that means noon tomorrow, they should be be ready if we get everything. By 10 a.m., we have the appraisal, we have the scope of work, we have the inspection. We submit that to the underwriter. We tell, hey, Mr. Underwriter, can we speed this up a little bit? Because here's the other 7 deals we did and we're good with our numbers. We can get the green light on that day. We might be able to do it. So you can tell us about a deal Monday, tell us about it before 10 in the morning, if you can, 7 to 10, and we might be able to close the next day. We might be able to close. Sometimes, I never promise this, we can't even close that day, depending on the situation. But this is how, realtors, other people come to you with deals. And how do you get them to come with $25,000 deals? I said, write down, before we did this class, I said, write down some of the deals we had. I don't know if you have the examples. We had 4 deals this month that were more than $20,000. Deals that came directly from a real estate agent who had a deal that fell apart. And they said, listen, can you step in and close real quick? Because they don't have anyone that can close real quick. And they still look like a genius to their person. So again, you as a passive investor, I get it. You don't want to be involved with this stuff, but you need to know these are the only 7 things you need to close quickly. The propaganda package isn't necessary. So really only 6 things. Know how the closing process works and work with your team. Suggest these things. If they're still being LCs about it, let us know. We can work with them too. And we'll train your team for free. We'll tell them exactly how to do this. Especially if they're in Indiana. They won't do it though. I'm only saying that because that's a red herring. They're not going to do it. Why do you think I'm so openly telling this stuff? Nobody's going to fucking do it. People who paid us to tell them how to do it still don't do it unless we do it for them. So set a record and work with your team to beat it and then advertise it so everybody knows. This is what we say in our propaganda package. Call me and I'll close the deal in 24 to 48 hours. I guarantee it. If I don't close on a deal within 24 to 72 hours, I'll give you $5,000 cash. We don't say that on the internet. We say that in our propaganda package though, because we mean it. If you send us a deal, we'll tell you exactly what we can close it at and we'll be within, we'll be really close to knowing when we get out there. Like with everything, your team should know these numbers. So, oh my goodness. Okay, how much money can you actually make doing this? How much money can your team, or if you're an active investor? So we did the math on this. If you look at the MLS, how many deals in your target area fall apart? When we looked at the Indianapolis market, it's about 1 to 5%, about 3 to 5%, about 3 to 7%, 7 to 10%, depending on the area. So it's about 5% of pending deals. These are deals that get an offer. They end up needing another offer. They end up falling apart, right? So they need a good, fast offer. So here's a quick way of doing this. We go out there, we make contact. We're screening about 40. Is it 20 to 40 a month? So to do one deal a week, like I said, 4 deals in the last month. To do one deal a week, we screen 40 a month. Is that what you're doing right now? 40 a month? So the way that works is in your target area, as soon as a deal that you wanted or that you look good went pending, contact that realtor. We send them a congratulations. We send them a note, a letter. Hey, good job. We really pat them on the back. By the way, real quickly, if something happens with that deal and you need a quick offer, let us know, because we know that 5% or 1 out of 20. So if we contact 40 a month, we get 2 deals a month out of that. Is that right? Then how is it 1 a week? Is it through the follow-up? I see. Oh, so it doubles. Oh, I see. So 40 a month over the course of 2 or 3 months ends up being 1 a week, because we're in touch with those people with a drip campaign and a follow-up. So we're able to do that. So that's about like 1 a day, right? So 1 contact a day ends up being an extra like $70,000 a month. 1 contact at 40 a month. Yeah, that's fucking brilliant, man. That's amazing. So, okay. So 5%, Anna made a class on this. She actually put a whole put on how to make offers on pending, or how to make backup offers, how to find motivated sellers with backup offers. This is a while ago, like a year or two ago. Ever since then, this is how we do it. We find deals that are pending. As soon as they get pending, hey, congratulations, good job. We send them a little gift like brownies or something like that, so that we get their attention. Then we send them the propaganda package. By the way, if you need a quick offer, let us know. And that produces about 1 a week, 1 deal extra a week. And usually the profit on that for it to be a deal is, $5,000, $10,000, $20,000. It should be at least. These will be deals with motivated sellers who want out. This is an entirely invisible market. What I just went through, you talk to any real estate investor, anybody in real estate, they'll agree. Yeah, a lot of deals that go pending end up not, they end up not being, that was the last page. They end up not being, they end up, needing a second offer. And you ask them, okay, so what are you doing about that? And I guarantee you, they're not doing anything about it. This is an easy way to go out there and get this done. Let's do a quick recap here. If you're a passive investor, first, this is the first series of many tips to come, but passive investing, our whole stuff, we went over our kind of our culture here. You want to change the world. You want to make cool things happen. Realize your time is limited. You don't have a lot of time. You got to focus and make the most of your time. And there's nothing more important that you're going to do financially speaking than create passive income. Tips like this are going to allow you to screen your team better and then train them better. Now you know how to close light speed closings. It's not about you going out and doing it as a passive investor. As an active investor, you definitely want to go out and do this. But as a passive investor, make sure your team gets trained to do this stuff. I promise you they're not doing this. They're not doing it as well as they could. In almost every case, if they are, let us know, because I'll be their investor. But that doesn't happen ever. Then when you introduce stuff, maybe they're going to be LCs about it. They're not going to take it very seriously, in which case you should look at getting another team. It doesn't matter if you're in Indiana or somewhere else. If you need help, text Anna. The number is on your screen, 317-969-5619. Give her a text first. Please don't call her. That really is her direct line. She does answer. Send her a text. If you have problems with any of your team in Indiana, or you want to apply to be one of our investors, the way to go is a text. Text us. You can apply. Or if you need help or something, we'll make sure you get that fixed. This is how you can close fast and get better deals. I promise you, getting better at getting this machine down and closing closing fast will change your life, and your team will be able to bring you better and better deals. And it's one of those things you put in place once and you're going to have residual benefit for it. It's going to be amazing and beautiful, just like me, just like you. I love you.